Thanks.
Thanks.
I
still
got
it.
Just
shout out to
the Walmart. So I welcome to University of Pierre Marie Curie, and so I'm Jean-Claude Bajard, head of Computer Science Research Department of the University. So we call it in France a laboratory, but it's not the same in other countries. So you will see that it's a huge laboratory, so huge department. So we depend of university, UPMC, but also of CNRS, which is the National Science Center for the research in France. So our laboratory, the research is driven by the applications. So we have a lot of partnerships with industry or partner, and the main focuses of our lab are around the security, the data science, and the smart devices. And so I will explain a little bit how the laboratory is organized, but first, to give you an idea of the size of the laboratory, we have around 200 faculties and 200 PhD students. And depending of the period of the year, around 100 or 200 postdoctoral engineers, internship, master degree students. So it's a huge laboratory. We have also some partnership with INRIA, which is known in the computer science research. So we have we can say prestigious grant given to some of our researchers. So ERC are European grants, a prestigious European grant. And we have also some partnership shares, and also from the Institut Universitaire de France, IUF, some prestigious professor, you know, maybe Guy Pujol in the list. So we have also some prestigious grant from the French government. They call it Programme of Excellence. So maybe you know the testbed future Internet of Things. The coordination is made by Serge Vida in the university. That it's a consortium of different partners over the France, and there are also now partnerships with a lot of countries. And I know that they have a new partnership with the United States and Taiwan and yes, a lot of countries. So we have also some laboratory of excellence. And so that means that it's a group of people from different thematics, from mathematics, biology, medicine, and so computer science too. To work on some specific topics. So you can see the three main topics here. And I try to have a quick presentation, so sorry. I will leave after the slide. So, so we have also inside, you know, our university belongs to Sorbonne University. So inside the Sorbonne University, we have a lot of partnerships of different kind. So I don't plan to go into the details. And also in Paris, with different kind of partnership. You see with links, you kind of so that you can see that we have also links with other partners in Paris around the network. So that is just to say that the financial support of the lab are half from academic support, a quarter from France, a quarter from Europe, and other partnerships. So it depends on industrial collaborations. We have publication, but you can see on our website all the publications, so I don't want to say more on that. So the organization of the laboratory is divided in departments. So and department in each department you can find several teams, and so two departments have some interest for ONOS. Let's see department. So here it's a networks and systems. So I will just detail the teams of this department, and also complex system, which is also a department with some teams concerned by ONOS, who can be concerned by ONOS. So okay, so about the Department of Network and Systems, you have two teams really making research on networks. So one is a network performance analysis team, and for example, the test bed driven by Serge Guida is in this team. And also the team FAR, you know Stefano sitting here, so he belongs to this team with Guy Pujol. And so they work on network, and so one more on network analysis, and FAR more on the different kind of protocol and dynamic networks. So we have also teams working more on systems. And so there's Regal, so it's distributed system, and Whisper is more involved in all the bugs that we can find in the system. So they have some tools to debug, and they are really involved in the Linux construction. And we have also a team working on cryptography with Antoine Jou. Antoine Jou obtained the Gödel Prize 2 years ago, or 3 years ago now. So, and the other department that can be concerned by ONOS is a complex system department with the team MOVE, working on model checking, and also maybe a complex network working on large scale network analysis. But here is not in terms of protocol, it's more, we can say they can analyze, for example, some kind of attacks or some kind of social networks. For example, with now terrorism or things like that. So that's the main things. We are involved in a master degree. So this is a huge master degree because each year we have 400 students who obtain their diploma. So it's a things that could interest a lot of you if you, because there are internships and you are welcome if you ask to Stefano. And also we are in a doctoral school, and so this doctoral school is larger than UPMC because it's also with telecom, but telecom will go to SACTEC. So in 1 year, Lipsys will be the biggest partner of EBIT. So thank you and welcome. Again.
Good morning. It's good to see everyone here. Not quite everyone yet, but I appreciate you being here at 9 o'clock. And it's really fun to be here in Paris. I love the city of Paris. We've been very fortunate with the weather, as I've been here when Paris isn't quite as sunny as it has been. And it's very good to reconnect with many friends here. What I think also fun is to meet many new friends who are interested in working in this area. All right, Andreas. Sorry.
Just go full screen. Oops.
Full charges. Okay. I didn't mean to play a slideshow of my whole presentation. That's it. But anyways, what I want to do first is, I love this photograph of the person going to Almost Build. You're probably very familiar with it. Very fortunate, we have many different affiliations that are represented here today. A number of students, many from UPMC. Huawei has a number of people here that have been very active in the Almost project. Orange, Sub 6, and the Polytechnico, Twino, as well as RSS. You can see a long tail of organizations that are represented here, so that's exciting. Also, many countries. So, of course, France is a leading country, which makes sense. But we also have people from around the world. So it's a very global group here today. Okay, I wanted to provide you maybe with a little bit of context for Onos. We've been living Onos for more than 4 years now. And with that context, maybe provide a little bit of motivation to join us on this journey. We started Onos again 4 years ago, shortly after Open Networking Lab opened. Open Networking Lab is a nonprofit public benefit organization in Menlo Park, California. And this whiteboard. This is the first time we actually wrote Onos on the whiteboard. This was back in September or October of 2012. And at the time, we were trying to understand where we could impact, which part of the industry we should go after to provide an impact. In data center, there was a lot of innovation already. NYSERA was out there, been acquired by VMware. And so we were trying to understand what we could do in the wide area network. So that's where we started, thinking that we'd provide a wide area network controller. This was the first architecture slide that we came up with in November of 2012. It's much simpler back then than it is now. We've had a lot to it. But some of the same basic concepts were valued at that time, the modularity and the importance of abstractions. We continued to iterate on that architecture into January. We provided our first demonstration at the Open Network Summit in April of 2013. And we had a wonderful user interface at that time compared to many controllers. And it was good because it generated a lot of interest. It was dangerous because many people thought that it was a real system and that it was operational and they could go manage a network with it. So from there, we've come to a place where we have quite a few fellow participants on this journey. And we're very fortunate to be supported by these partners, some the very largest operators and the vendors that support those operators. And from the beginning, our mission has been to help the operators be successful in transforming their networks by using open source. And although open source isn't new in the world of computing, it's very new in the world of networking. In addition to partners that provide the support for our engineering team, we have many, many collaborators who help bring value into the ecosystem. Whether that is through software, or whether that's through help on the standard side, or whether that's through deployments. These are the companies that I say probably bring some of the most impact in to what's happening on Onos. From the humble beginnings of that whiteboard, we have now had 8 releases of Onos. They release quarterly. The most recent one was Hummingbird. And now this is our first build meetup. And so it's really exciting that you're all here and part of that. So I'll end here just to say what our mission is about. Okay, why are we putting so much energy into this? We want to build a better network. Okay, the network that we have today is built pretty much the same way it's been built for 40 years. There's thousands of protocols. The boxes that are in place were never meant to be able to be software controlled, to be agile, to be able to support the types of applications that we have now on mobile devices and that we can't even imagine yet because we don't have that agility. And so we believe we can build a better network. We're doing this for the public good. We want to, again, stop with the closed and proprietary, complex and expensive systems, and through open collaboration, bring a new base of infrastructure. And we want networks that enable innovation rather than stifle innovation. So I hope you'll join us in that mission. Very big thanks to UPMC and Loop6 for providing the facilities for this and the support. Also to our additional sponsors, Platinum Level, we have Sienna, Fujitsu, and Huawei. And if you don't know, both Sienna and Huawei provide commercial support for the Onos controller. And we have at Gold, Radisys and Kisti. Radisys also provides commercial support on the port side. And then Silver Level, Gami.net, and Darren. We thank them very much for their support because we couldn't hold a conference like this without their support. So one last thank you is many people contributed to the success of this, but 2 people in particular I want to say thank you to, and that's William Quivager and David Boswell, our community director and manager, and really appreciate all the effort they put into making this happen. So thanks.
Thank you, Bill, and thank you to everybody for joining us today. And as Bill said, my name is David Boswell. And just to add one more thanks, our planning team, William and I, couldn't have done this without Andrea as well. So thank you. And I'd just like to give you a little bit of a preview of what's coming up next. There will be a coffee break, but first we have 2 additional speakers. So I'd like to welcome you to Elio Salvadori, who's joining us from Italy, and then he will be followed by Thomas Basuska. And then after that, again, we'll have a coffee break, and then we'll tell you more about the program for the rest of the day as well. So welcome again.
Hello, everybody. My name is Elio Salvadori. I'm the managing director of CREANET. CREANET is a resource center focusing on network and telecommunication located in northern Italy, in Trento. And I'm really glad that, for this invitation. Honored that Volk and Bill actually contacted me some time ago, asking if I was available to give such talk, and I was really happy because we have been actually among the ones that have been seeing all these almost actually evolution and impact that all together we are trying to build. So that's why I was thinking to give to leverage what today's presentation to go together with you and share not only let me say our vision on Onos, but also leverage and understand, share together the how the old SDN and controller evolved along these years. And actually, when I was thinking about evolution, I was really thinking about, you know, how many things happened actually in only 8-10 years from now. We have been working on something that started as a very basic concept that was introducing something very new, as Bill was saying before, for this specific ecosystem. We are contributing to build a very new concept that can do very complicated things. And that's why I got this picture from the Encyclopedia Britannica showing, you know, how, you know, the evolution of birds, since we are here and talking about the Onos. Well, yes, actually everything, so you'll go through a bit of history. For some of you, still, these are things very well known. For others, maybe it's a way to see things from a new perspective. Actually, everything started with the OpenFlow. OpenFlow was actually the result, if I remember well, of some activity that was done on funded by, I guess, by NSF on Translate Internet Architectures. And the idea was to separate, the original idea was to separate the control plane from the forwarding plane. And this actually, this key concept enabled and triggered a lot of innovation, because it was really perceived as a way to not only facilitate the disaggregation of networks, but also to enable things like virtualization of network infrastructure. And more importantly, making a very closed ecosystem like the one we've been working for years, getting open. And this was very new. And of course, big vendors at the beginning were pretty resistant to that change. But slowly, you know, it started, and everything, many people started getting engaged more and more. The first controllers appeared. I guess all of us know the NOX, the network operating system, was among the first. And then actually, well, somebody was able to demonstrate these things could work actually in a production system like a data center. So even actually a few startups also started their operation. You all may remember Casado's startup this year that was acquired by VMware, and then also Big Switch with Guido Zeller and Rob Sherwood. And people also were also thinking that, well, OpenFlow was not probably the only way to realize this architecture. So already at that time, there were also other, let me say, efforts. More controllers appeared. In most cases, were kind of toy controllers. They were still coming from academy. Others not. For example, Floodlight, you know, is part of the code developed by Big Switch. And also other controllers that were never released publicly, like the ones developed by NEC or HP, and even Onyx, that actually was a collaboration between NEC, Google, NEC, that was presenting, it was one of the first controller presenting the distributed architecture that was intended to be more robust compared to the standard, purely centralized control architecture. And it was really at that time, and probably you have also seen from Bill's slides, that also the first seeds of more ambitious open source projects started. I guess more or less in parallel, ONOS, Open Daylight, the first seeds were there. And let's not forget that also 2012 was also the year where when Etsy launched the NFV working group, that it was always being, let me say, it was always said that it was complementary towards the end, but it is also true that it is, there is a very tight link between these two worlds. Since I'm here also to present how, you know, Create.net actually has been moving its first steps into this world and into ONOS in particular, I must say that our first steps were really very close to the time of publication of the OpenFlow paper. At the time, I've been working for years on optical networks. So for me, it was always the forwarding plane separated from the counter plane. So it was pretty easy and let me say natural. Let me say to move into OpenFlow, and I was very very much interested in understanding how we could leverage on this technology to realize network slicing. So we played a lot with FlowVisor. I was already at the time interacting a bit with Rob Sherwood, that was the guy behind FlowVisor. And we did some evolution that actually finally also became part of the what is now known as OpenVertex. Well, of course, my first love was Carrier Networks. And of course, like many, many other people, we were all concerned about how a complex system like a wide area network with all the complexities of distance and everything, definitely much more complex than a data center network, how could we realize a controller that is, you know, robust enough, that can scale enough to manage such networks? We had the chance to start a collaboration with Jean. Jean is the largest backbone of NRAN networks in Europe, and they were investing on some innovation projects through some open course, and we were really pushing this concept. And in parallel, actually, I guess it was October 2012, I had the chance to meet Bill and Ali. During the EWSDN, it was the first conference in Europe on SDN, and we started discussing about these concepts, and I also had the chance to have my colleague Matteo that was willing to do some experience abroad. So I said, why not spend some time in Tonga? There was a lot of things moving. He moved there for almost 1 year, and actually did contribute to both OpenVertex. And he was also helping unlock the fork in developing the first prototype, the one Bill was showing before that it was demonstrated during the ONS 2013. I remember at the time also there was some discussion with Bill about, you know, we were really willing to contribute, you know, and I remember even for Bill, it was something actually very new, because in this world, nothing like this was there. So how find the right way of collaborating, you know, even from remote, you know, completely different timing. And I remember that Bill was mentioning to me that they met, actually, I guess, even a seminar from Yono Bacon, that was is one of the most known community manager. It was behind Ubuntu. And that's why I guess gave them a lot of hints about how to start, you know, completely all new open source project with contribution coming from all over the world that you need to properly manage and handle. So then coming back to the scenario, then there was really the boom. SDN really exploded. everything becomes software-defined, you know, not only data centers, everything, enterprise, mobile, transport networks. All, also, the major vendors started investing on this technology, and this really changed completely the perspective. Really, OpenFlow was not anymore synonym of SDN, and there were also competing protocols on the southbound interface, and they still are there, actually, as you know. And finally, well, these were really the years where the largest, let me say, carrier-grade control platform were finally published and advertised. So, if I remember well, it was 2014, the year where Open Daylight was released around spring, I guess, and almost around fall, something like that. It was kind of 5-6 months timing between the two public releases. And now, I mean, we know, I mean, I guess it is not just my personal feeling, but I guess almost Open Daylight are really de facto reference platforms. There are still closed source controllers, but they are not so much spread around. Onos has been doing a lot of improvements. I remember the initial architecture, the one Bill was showing, was really leveraging the architecture was not really probably. There were a lot of dependencies among models. There was they were leveraging on Hazelcast and Zookeeper to keep to maintain consistency to as a publisher's mechanism, and those things were really creating troubles to the performance of the platform. So when the first open source release was finally published, there has been a lot of work on improving and particularly in getting rid of Hazelcast and Zookeeper. The architecture became much more cleaner and elegant, and of course everything would has been thought in order to facilitate the reuse of services. And also the concept was also to go a little more, not only open flow and MC driven, but also taking into account also other southbound protocols like NetConf, PCP, and so on. And a lot of things happened, actually. The Onos community started moving its first steps. Many projects took that started from some Onos, let me say, activity, became really a reference project themselves. You know, I just mentioned Cord. I don't know how much we will talk in these 2 days about Cord, but it's a very, very important project. Also, the activity on packet optical integration has been also has been realized by many other groups around the world, also in Japan. Finally, we are here. You know, the largest event organized by the Onos community in that we really thought as a way to engage more developers, making them add them in contributing skills and knowledge on Onos. Well, just one last slide about our ongoing contributions. We've been releasing actually this Icona application that is the idea is to make Onos even more scalable at a geographical level, because we know when you are dealing with a very wide area networks, you may face troubles of performance. But it's been also, of course, as any concept has been evolving into managing multi-domain scenarios. We've been we get involved in even more on the Onyx community. We've been doing some tutorial to young people in June last year. We've organized the first Onyx hackathon during the WSDN last year in Bilbao. And you can see here Matteo and Ali with the nice mask. Well, Michele was also has been also visiting OnLab this year. Here you can see him with Andrea and Thomas, deeply involved in a hard programming session on Call of Duty and beers. and he also organized 2 months back together with OnLab and the Telecom Italia people a core the Onyx workshop in. Team Innovation Labs in Turin, many actually providers were invited to attend and actually join. We had around 70-80 people there, and it was, let me say, a nice opportunity to make people aware of these two projects. Well, and then Michele is acting as our Onyx ambassadors. We are involved in the community steering team, and we are. Our people, I mean, not myself, but my people, I know they are involved into, you know, contributing to the Onyx mailing list, to the documentation. And in general, we have been investing, especially in the last 2 years, in other domains, like, you know, the optical domain, on control interoperability, on mobile networks. We have several, mostly, let me say, European-funded projects. Where we are working on these concepts. We are trying hard with private stakeholders, but unfortunately, the European context, the overall context of SDN in Europe is not an easy one. This is at least our experience. So what's next? I have these two last slides. One is more on the technical side of the future, and one more on the community. We believe that there is still a lot of room in favoring interoperability of applications between the Onyx and the Open Daylight. There are, you know very well, there are several ways to do that. You know, both managing or working on more on the northbound side with intents, or on east-west. Let me say protocols. There are projects like Englewood that is part of ONF, which is working on a transport API to facilitate these interoperability of controllers on transport networks. We are contributing to some of them. I guess another big challenge also is, and I know almost. And all our people are very much involved into is this white box concept. We believe that there will be definitely also the need to handle hybrid scenarios or migration scenario where you have to somehow slowly, if you want to get rid of closed and proprietary boxes, you need to think on a more on a migration path and Onyx should somehow facilitate this and demonstrate that the potential KPIs you are saving, they are not completely transforming to OPEX that you have as a trade-off of your migration. We are now more recently investing a lot on the access segment of mobile networks because we see there are a lot of space also for these 5G networks. And we don't see many activity happening there on the SDN side. This is something different from what MCORD is doing, which is more on the backhaul. This is more on the access side of the future mobile networks. And security is also something that is. Especially when you scale to the level Onyx is targeting to scale, this is really is a key aspect you need to take care of. how to make quantum data plane robust to potential attacks, but also to misbehaving applications, for example, applications that take a lot of resources and may compromise the performance of other applications. And we are also contributing on this, and hopefully we will release many of the things we are doing through ONOS also on publicly. From the community point of view, I think, as I said before, I mean, it's not that easy to get major stakeholders involved, or events like this, and the one we are here these days are very good ones from this point of view, because we make people more aware of what is happening, how they can contribute. I think it would be, this is more, you know, it's kind of result of an internal brainstorm I had with my people. There are still probably things that can be improved from the point of view of the decision process. I know there have been a lot of improvements. We were thinking that maybe it could be an idea, maybe also to adapt or adopt, pardon, concepts like the blueprints also in this community. You know, blueprints is a way, OpenStack, for example, how can I say, manage contributions from the overall community with a process that of selection and a roadmap toward the potential integration to the overall project. Definitely, the ONOS brigades that I'm sure you will hear again during these 2 days are a promising step toward this major engagement. And we were also thinking that it could be maybe the time, maybe not, I'm not sure if it is already the right time, but start thinking about having certified training paths, like the ones also other major open source projects had, where you know, people go through a certification, they are really qualified to contribute, to promote, to deploy ONOS in real settings. So this is just a few suggestions. That's it. I don't know if you have any questions, any curiosity. I'm here these 2 days, or 1 day and a half somehow. Yes.
Sorry,
ONOS Brigades.
What's this organization or some?
I'm sure probably even Gori, you can give a better explanation of that, right?
Okay.
Well, I'll be brief because we, as Elio said, we will definitely have more information about that throughout the week. But you know, I definitely agree with Elio's point that we need to open up, you know, our processes and decision making and authority and responsibility to a wider group of the community, and the brigades was one way to do that. Basically, and this ties into what Thomas will be talking about, we started the brigade effort in the summer. We identified the top 4 or 5 items in the roadmap that we wanted the community to come in and help us with, and we basically said, hey, let's do this as a group, come in, help us with these 4 or 5 things over the next 3 months. And we've seen a really great response from the community. There's a handful of brigade members here today. They're really helping drive forward the innovation on the roadmap. And going forward, we're going to do even more of this. So we're going to invite, at the end of the year, we're going to invite community to recommend their own brigade ideas and to step up and really drive initiatives on their own. And I invite everybody here to make sure they stay throughout the entire program, because the program ends on Friday with brigades, each of the brigades demoing what they've been working on today.
Okay, thanks. So, okay, next question is to the previous slides. Okay.
The previous?
Okay, I think that I think that your many of your suggestions is are very good. Okay, I think that this is the direction is expected by many the SDN controller open source developers. So here, so I think that the besides this suggestion, I want to add more suggestions, because now we know that the owners have provided a strong base for the developers. But I think in order to facilitate the development, I hope that owners can build more, maybe some of the automation tools and also some of this the framework, so facilitate the development of the open source developers, so they can work out the solution more efficiently. Okay, that's my suggestion. Okay. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, well, then thanks again. Enjoy the rest of the event.
Thank you, Guido. And again, I'd like to introduce you to our chief architect, Onos Thomas. And we do invite everybody to have, he's going to present a lot of information about the roadmap of Onos going forward. I hope you have a lot of questions. I would just say hold your questions until after the break, and we're going to have all the members of the Onos technical steering team here right after the break, and you can ask them anything you would like. So welcome, Thomas.
Thanks, David. Thanks, everyone. I'm just going to, pardon the brief logistical swap over. Okay, I need your help. This is the town keyboard. And I'm counting to shut this up. That should work. That's good. Okay, thank you. So I'm going to talk to you just a little bit of an overview of Onos, just to make sure that everybody is reset on the same page, even though I'm pretty sure that most of you are already familiar with Onos, otherwise you probably wouldn't be here. And then also I'm going to give you a sort of a brief glance at some of the functionality that we've built over the since we've released, and as well as also peek at what we have in mind for building into the future. And so clearly Onos is a platform for developing SDN and IT solutions for service providers, but also of course of other network operators like campus and data center operators as well. It's because it's aimed at operating on critical networks, mission critical networks. It needs to be based on a fault tolerant core, which is distributed, because it also needs to provide scalability and performance at the same time. So those three tenets are key to the architecture. It also needs to be built, as Bill alluded to, around strong abstractions in order to assure portability of applications. And it needs to be a flexible applications platform, because different deployments will require different solutions and different sets of use cases and applications built on top of the platform. So, as everybody knows, Onos is written in Java. It's built on top of an OSGI framework and a container, specifically Apache Carafe and Felix. And on top of that, we built it as a distributed platform, which is physically distributed set of compute nodes, but they are logically centralized. And I will talk more about it later. The cluster can be dynamically adjusted in size to adjust to different increases in workload or decreases. On top of that, applications platform, which has nothing to do really with networking at its base, we built a networking core, a set of base abstractions for controlling networks, both and representing networks in order to have a sort of a standard mental picture for applications to work with. And then it's key to note that the ONOS networking core is designed to be as minimal as possible, because as I mentioned before, the different deployments will require different sets of applications, and it's much easier to add stuff than it is to remove stuff. So the ONOS networking core is indeed as small as we could make it. And instead, when we rely to add additional functionality, we rely on ONOS applications. But this is where a lot of value lies. Now, so ONOS, what do you say, what do you mean by applications? So ONOS applications are really, these are on-platform applications that run within the same OSGI framework and the same process and operate in a manner which is indistinguishable from the components which are running in the ONOS core. Now, those are components that belong to different classes of different tiers of the architecture. They can be low-level southbound drivers or protocol providers, or they could be network traffic steering applications, or they can be some utility monitoring tools and things like that. So, well, throughout the spectrum of the stack, the one can extend the core functionality really easily and following the same patterns in which the core is built. Now, you know, we have a plethora of applications as it stands today. You will recognize a lot of them. But the point here is not to talk about those, at least right now, but clearly they're the key. So ONOS can be extended not only within the stack, but also on the surfaces on the outside. So CLIs, GUI can be extended as well as REST API. And the point is that the extensions should be virtually indistinguishable from what comes with the base product. The idea is to seamlessly extend these surfaces so that from a user standpoint, they can't tell the difference which is what. They just see the extended functionality. So as a brief retrospective, we started longer ago, and you got the older history from Bill and Uriel. Since we open sourced in December 2014, we open sourced only with four applications and one southbound plugin, which was OpenFlow, and with a minimal platform. But the idea here was that the code had to be clean and modular, that we can build on it, that it provide a stable platform. And since then, we've added functionality in a couple of different areas, and different releases were focusing on either innovating or showcasing some use cases, but also there were releases that focused on further hardening the platform. Because it needs to be kept in balance, otherwise if you focus only on developing new features, your production readiness can decrease and so forth. So the key is that the coherence of the code base in the architecture needs to be maintained, but also needs to be a platform where innovation thrives. So at this point in time, I think we're on our ninth release or something like that. There are about 80 applications, which include southbound plugins, drivers, and samples. And there are many different distributed primitives that can be used to build the application distributed cores. So as everybody knows, we've been releasing on quarterly basis. The first release was the AVOS set, where we just set the clean modular code base and protocol independence. In the following release, we decided to focus on performance, because although we had scalability and reasonable performance in AVOS set, there were a few things we were ourselves disappointed in, and so we wanted to focus on addressing those issues. In the third release, we demonstrated further use cases, specifically one of them was core. Which is now its own separate project, and we've added additional core features and additional protocols with the help of many of our partners and contributors. And in break, this was time to focus on platform and reinforcing some of the prototype features that were added as part of the new use cases and so forth. So you can see the theme here is that sometimes the platform is giving attention, sometimes new features are getting the attention, and sometimes we just focus on use cases and demonstrations, which then later on need to be hardened. Clearly the last three releases, which is Falcon, GoldenEye, Hummingbird, you can see, I'm not going to go through full details, but you can see the theme in here, you know, where we added a platform capability for dynamic clustering and model extensibility and so forth. So let's talk about what's in current release that's currently underway, which is Ibis. Specifically, there are a couple of key initiatives that we're working on, and one of them is dynamic configuration of devices and services. Now, this is something where we honestly are a little bit behind, for example, behind Open Daylight. And so we want to close that gap. And the idea here is to allow configuration of devices, in the dynamic configuration of devices at runtime, to be conducted using N-based models and the conf and restconf protocols. Also, virtualization is something that we started incubating, actually, I think in the break release, which is over a year ago, but then we didn't have a chance to give it our full attention because of other initiatives. And so we're returning to focus on virtualization. And the idea here is to provide, unlike the Nicira approach or OpenStack approach, we're wanting to provide virtualization that actually generates virtual networks which are SDN programmable. And we're working on this sort of under the brigade model that was discussed earlier. We're also working on UI scalability enhancements. Now, this is not necessarily from the standpoint of the user interface itself, but mostly from usability standpoint. You can actually present thousands of nodes on a topology UI, but technically they will get wrong actually rather fast. However, it makes it really easy makes it really difficult for a human to be able to find things, organize things in a logical way. And so the UI scalability enhancements provide support to make this information more easily digestible to an operator. And I will talk more about that later. As we're working with various deployment sites in research networks and other areas, where the intent framework is actually being used to provide, using the SDN IP functionality to provide connectivity between the various autonomous systems. There were a few features that were lacking, and so one of our focuses for this, focal points for this release is to enhance the existing intent framework to be able to cover some of those deficiencies. So the near-term roadmap items, which include the ones in current release and beyond, are sort of the following prioritized list of high-level sets of functionality. I already briefly mentioned the dynamic configuration, and I will talk more about in detail later. It's the virtualization, it's the UI scalability, it's in-service software upgrade, external APIs for off-platform applications using gRPC. It's further working and elaborating on a federation model, and then coming up with a second version of our intent subsystem, where we want to take some of our experiences from the current one and address some of its deficiencies and take it basically to the next stage. And also, even though I alluded to the separate platform and separate cores, they are for the most part separate, but there are still a few areas where they're tied together. And so what we would like to do is actually officially separate the distributed platform and network core separation into sort of separate projects. So let's talk about the dynamic configuration. The service providers have been asking us to introduce this capability because they have a need to be able to interact, perform configuration, not flow programming. For flow programming, actually, we receive very positive feedback that the existing abstractions that we provide, which are flow rules, flow objectives, and intents, are actually adequate for programming the forwarded plane. However, as part of a Brilliant network, you can also need to be able to orchestrate and provision the devices and configure them as part of the initial setup. And this is where operators prefer to use sort of a unobstructed view to the configuration of the devices. So if the devices are configured through Yang models, whether they're standard or proprietary, service providers want direct access to those models. Not direct as in means that they don't actually talk directly to the device, but they want to talk through the model, whether it is proprietary or standard. So if, for example, the providers are working with a vendor who gives them a specific sense of functionality or tailored functionality, they would like to be able to access that without any sort of obstruction in between. And so this is something that we're building currently. We are building a set of Yang sort of facilities. They comprise of Yang compiler to be able to take the Yang models and produce the Java source files, as well as some schema metadata, which then can be further compiled using JDK and assembled into sort of deployable extensions to ONOS. We're also building, as part of this, a Yang runtime subsystem, which can be used to dynamically serialize and deserialize external formats such as XML or JSON as it's fed through protocol adapters such as RESTful, CONNECTCON, or others into the system. And so the Yang runtime helps basically to translate between different representations. And we also one of the key parts is the development of the Yang store, which is what allows it to operate as a distributed platform for the distributed configurations platform, where, for example, an application can exercise control from one node in a cluster over a device that is connected to another node in the cluster. And also can happen in a fault-tolerant way. So, for example, if in the middle of an operation the node happens to fail, the operation will be resumed somewhere else in the cluster. And so that is what is expected, and that's what we're building in current release. It probably won't be ready in IBIS, but we are aiming for demonstrating some functionality in ONS timeframe, which will be following the J release. One of the things I want to mention here is that despite the emphasis being placed on Yang and Yang sort of Yang-driven model development, there's actually surprisingly few adequate tools for working with Yang today, at least in Java. And so we want to make sure we pay particular attention on developing set of Yang tools which are really portable, not and are usable even outside of context of ONOS. So that's dynamic configuration. Now, that applies not only to devices themselves, but also to be able to model interactions with ONOS or ONOS applications through Yang. So basically modeling services. Because service providers are interested in being able to interface ONOS with their own orchestration platforms using interactions which are governed by service model. So on the virtualization side, I've already briefly mentioned that we want to produce virtual networks which are SDN capable. What I mean by that is that in OpenStack, virtual networks are generally just collections, amorphous collections of end hosts which have implied connectivity, L2, L3, or otherwise. But they have no structure to them, and they really can't be controlled beyond that. And the idea here is to provide almost the converse of this, which is a collection, which is basically a network with a structure, which can be embedded onto the underlying network either manually through configuration or automatically through computation. And that network has no inherent connectivity. But instead, the connectivity can be programmed using a variety of different means, either using some sort of an external protocol such as OpenFlow, or potentially via REST using abstractions such as flow objectives or intents. And the idea is to support arbitrary topology so that you can construct a virtual network which is as simple as a big switch or as complex as the underlying network underneath it using isomorphic mapping. Now, of course, since ONOS itself is protocol independent, means it abstracts applications from the knowledge of what underlying protocol is used to interact with the devices, the virtualization subsystem needs to follow the same pattern, which means we are more than just a pass-through to OpenFlow devices underneath. So the idea is to facilitate, for example, OpenFlow programming of virtual networks, which are backed by non-OpenFlow devices potentially underneath. So the idea is to follow the pattern of the virtualization being protocol independent. On the UI scalability enhancements, I've already gave a peek into this. The idea is to facilitate human interaction, and so to overcome more not the technical limitations, but more the human limitations of being able to digest limited amount of information at a time. And how we plan to do this is through supporting nested layouts, which means that rather than displaying the entire topology at a single flat representation, we allow the administrator to segment the topology into more of a like a tree layout, where you can imagine that a continental network can be, for example, divided into metros. Metro regions can be represented just basically a set of metro regions, and then you can drill into the metro region from where you can see potentially multiple data centers, from which you can actually see floor plans. You can dive it all the way to racks. So clearly, how nested is the structure, it depends entirely on how the deployment decides to represent that structure and represent their environment. But from a user interface standpoint, we plan to be able to support both visualization of physical layouts, which can be either geo maps or sort of site plans or floor plans, but also logical layouts, because for certain cases, it's easier to think of a network in a logical manner. For example, spine leaf network is much, you know, there's a standard sort of mental picture that everybody has of what a core network looks like. As part of this also, even though our UI today scales really nicely and pans and zooms, as part of the zooming today, we zoom the icons on a map sort of in an unconstrained manner, which makes it a little bit difficult to represent different densities on the geographical maps. And so the idea here is to be able to sort of throttle the icon scaling to have a minimum and maximum boundary. And that way, as you zoom out, you can dynamically adjust the proportion of the icons versus the background map. We also are updating our glyphs that we use for both the buttons as well as the devices with the help of a graphics designer and community. And also, as part of the addressing the scalability, we also are going to be adding, not in this release, but in future releases, ability to do a global search through the UI for basically through the entire network knowledge base. In-service software upgrade. This is a feature that has been actually on the roadmap for a long time, but we haven't simply gotten to it. But we view it as extremely important before we can enter service provider deployments in any scale, really. And the reason for this is we cannot expect a service provider to deploy ONOS without being able to upgrade it in a way where it does not disrupt their network. How we plan to accomplish this, we definitely have a sort of story and plan for accomplishing this, and it goes roughly like this. It's the idea is that ONOS is distributed, it's a cluster. So basically, we will take one node down, upgrade that node, bring it back up, have it join the cluster, and repeat the process on the next node until all of the nodes have been upgraded. And the idea here is that when you get the last one, ONOS is running a brand new version. Now, clearly, as you can see, this is predicated on the new software being able to engage in communications with the old software. So it requires what we call a portable serialization, something that can be something that basically can speak two languages at the same time. And for this, we intend to use something like group or role buffers because it supports a protocol evolution mechanism. This is something that we have not embarked on yet, but we're hoping that with the help of the community, we can form a brigade and start addressing this together. Closely related to this is gRPC APIs, whose goal is to provide fine-grained access to off-platform applications. So today, almost certainly can have off-platform applications because we do have a fairly rich REST API. But the REST API is really not, while it's ubiquitous and it's certainly very useful form of communication between sort of distributed applications, it is not really a suitable one for high frequency and low latency interactions because of the cost of setup of the REST calls, especially if you consider secure REST calls. So this is where gRPC aims to overcome, and it's going to be used heavily in Google, which is a certainly significant vote for it, right? So this will, having this fine-grained ability, have applications engaged in much richer set of interactions with ONOS. We hope to promote development of off-platform applications, which can then be deployed potentially using variety of different distributed and orchestration platforms, such as Kafka or other sort of services which manage, you know, microservice deployment. And this also will allow applications to be potentially written for operating on platform, but later time you may decide to run them off platform. And also clearly, you can develop applications which are written in a language other than Java. Cluster Federation, this is something that the work has already started on this with the help of the Icona project. Specifically working on a peer-to-peer variant. But we want to also develop a hierarchical model where you can actually develop a supercontroller which interacts with multiple subcontrollers underneath it. The idea here is that rather than the peers, whether it's peers or children, really doesn't matter, that a control domain does not expose its full detail of to its peers or to its parents, but instead that the lower controller exposes only a virtualized representation of its environment and allows manipulations of only a subset of its functionality. That's key in my view, because otherwise if you just propagate all of the information that you have yourself up to the parent or to the peer, you are essentially not getting any, you're not achieving any encapsulation, and you're not really achieving any scalability, because the bucket of information only gets bigger and bigger and bigger as you have more peers being federated or more children being federated with each other. So the key in here is to develop it in a way where that allows essentially a virtual network to be exposed to the peers or to the parent. The idea here is to support a model, not necessarily just a model where you have multiple different domains all operated by the same operator. This would be just a pure mechanism to achieve greater scalability. But we also want to be able to primarily focus on a more difficult problem, which is where you need to achieve interaction and cooperation between domains which are operated by different administrators and different potential operators. And which is why I think it's key to achieve some level of abstraction and virtualization, because you certainly wouldn't want some other control entity, administrative entity, to be able to control your entire network, right? That just wouldn't work. So it's not just necessarily about scalability, but it's also about abstracting and controlling the level of access that your peers have over your environment. And this is something that, you know, at least throughout the last 2 years, we've seen calls for this from various research networks. Because imagine an environment where you have large volumes of data produced in CERN, in Switzerland, which then need to be processed in San Diego Supercomputer Center. But in order to get from Switzerland to San Diego, it needs to pass through at least one long-haul research network or other, you know, potentially other these networks. And because of the large nature of the transfer, you need to be able to provision fairly wide lanes for transferring the data. And so this requires cooperation on multiple different domains. As far as Intent subsystem, sort of the next version, we call it Intent Domains 2.0. The idea here is that this capability, let me rewind a little bit. Today's Intent system allows introduction of new intents and new compilers for those intents to be able to introduce new primitives. So it's extensible sort of horizontally. But what we found out through experience is that it doesn't really lend itself to building intents on intents. So it doesn't really stack up. Plus, it's not very conducive to conflict resolution. And furthermore, it makes an assumption that an intent, that all networks will accomplish the same intent in the same way, which is clearly not the case. So that forced us to start developing, for example, connectivity intents for optical networks, which are different than those for packet network. And that clearly violates sort of the abstraction principle that we wanted to accomplish. But it ends up being a limitation of today's framework, and this is something that we would like to lift. And how we plan to accomplish this is by sort of picturing a network as a set of regions or domains where the controller over a certain region is given autonomy of figuring out how to accomplish certain intents. And so applications will no longer need to be concerned necessarily about what type of network they're going to be crossing or traversing when they're asking for, let's say, point-to-point or host-to-host or potentially broadcast-level intent. They simply express their intent as a primitive, either as a tunnel, as a sort of a broadcast funnel or any fast funnel, or potentially as a default route, which is basically a converging tunnel. And this way, that primitive is then given to the various domains that are going to be traversed, and they can each decide how they map that primitive onto their underlying network. So, for example, if you're crossing an optical network where provisioning circuits is expensive, but potentially subject to different constraints than on a packet network, you can take whatever steps necessary as a controller of that optical network. And so this will, this is hoping to provide applications with a little more isolation from having to know about the constraints of those networks. Now, of course, one of the limitations today of intent frameworks is also the fact that you can ask for an intent and it will work or it won't. Of course, we will do everything possible. The compilers will do everything possible to make it work and with the cooperation from the intent framework. But there will sometimes be conditions where it doesn't. Because you simply, let's say you've asked for just a little bit too much. But we offer no way of the framework telling you, you know, what you've asked for is almost possible, but not quite. Would you like this option instead? So it's very much like, for example, me saying that I would like to travel from San Francisco to Paris exactly 10 o'clock. And airlines say, no. It's not very helpful, but if they told me, you know, at 10:05 or 10:30, you could get a flight, and I'll say, okay, you know, I'll take that. So there's a little bit of a negotiation that needs to happen. And so we would like to introduce into this revised version of intent framework ability for application to request, essentially, an intent and be able to engage in selecting from a possible set of choices which either meet the demand or come close to it. And so this sort of a big offer mechanism is one of the enhancements that we plan to have done on the intent framework. So last, the platform and core separation is, it should be fairly obvious here. There are a few places where today the logic of separation is slightly violated, where we have few things together in same packages, which should be separated for historical reasons. And we thought that perhaps through a course of one release, once we have time to sort of focus on a platform, we would be able to separate the two. And why would we want to do that? For a number of different reasons. We've been in conversations with a couple of research sites like Fermi and Oak Ridge Labs, were among those, who are interested in actually using the ONOS distributed systems platform for controlling not necessarily network, but controlling other resources in their data center. And so this is where we need to sort of separate the domain knowledge, which is the networking core, from the underlying platform. And we're very, very close to that. We just need to actually make it sort of official and formal by separating those into a distinct distributed platform, application platform, and networking core. We feel that this will provide also a significant benefits in context of SDN itself as well. For when, for example, in the context of federation, you can actually run potentially slightly different flavors of ONOS using this. So clearly, there's a lot of work to be done. So how we want to get there is using the Brigade model, because we want to harness the power of community. Clearly, the on-lab team itself is very, very small. And so we don't have necessarily the horsepower to accomplish all of these things. And so the idea here is to consolidate the community around some of these sort of rallying points, functionality. And we've started to do that with dynamic configuration, virtualization, and UI scalability, as well as some of the deployment focus efforts. And so we would like to extend that model in the future to form more brigades around some of these enhancements. And this would put Owen Lab and the technical steering team mostly in the role of shepherds for those projects. We clearly want to be still involved in terms of be able to have feedback on the direction in which way this is heading, because we do have certain sort of, picture in our mind of how we think this ought to be accomplished. But of course, we may not necessarily know the best in all cases. And so the idea is to work with the community to get this done. So the number of brigades, which is today is 4, we expect to grow in the future. So I certainly hope everybody will become involved. And I invite everybody to attend the TST meetings, because this is where we discuss a lot of the current and potentially future projects and directions. And so we welcome your feedback and your participation. So that's it for me. Hopefully I didn't run too long on time. And I think the coffee break is next, right? All right, thank you very much.
Again, I hope you have a lot of questions with all the great information Thomas just shared. I would ask that you hold those questions for just 20 minutes, and all the members of the technical steering team will be up here right after the coffee break. So we'll have an hour to speak to them. So please help yourself for 20 minutes and join us back in here at 11. Thank you.
This is graceful, right?
Oh, yeah.
No, it's the thing is that actually the command the PowerPoint.
I was kind of facing you and not facing the audience. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. So one of the problems that I have the problem is the ending.
So what is what's going on? Was that a change order?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's about it. I think it's like itchy stage.
Yeah, he does it.
Yeah, and like I wonder what's past the itchy stage. And
yeah, I heard that for a while when I was out of town, but then she came back and said, I'm not having any of that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So, yeah, just.
Looks good, don't get me wrong. It's just a bug. It takes more to recognize, you know?
That's what a lot of people